everybody. Welcome to the PC Perspective Podcast. This is episode 147 for March 24th, 2011. I'm Ryan Trout.
I'm Jeremy Hellstrom.
I'm Josh Walrath.
And I'm Al Malventano.
And this is the podcast for PC Perspective. We're going to take you through a week's worth of news and reviews. We didn't have a whole lot of content. Everybody kind of rushes it in right here before the podcast. We've got some cool stuff to talk about today. And then we will definitely have some cool stuff to talk about next week as well. PCPer.com/podcast is the URL to share with your friends. Twitter.com/PCPer if you want to follow us and get our news, article updates, those types of things. Also, I'll mention this here at the beginning of the show, 1-888-38-PCPer is the number if you want to call in and leave us a voicemail. Podcast@PCPer.com is the email address to hit us up with some questions as well. Actually, in this week, because we kind of had a light discussion week, I brought in, we've got three or four voicemails and a couple of emails that we will get to. First thing I want to start with, if you haven't signed up for this already, it's too late. Sorry, you can't do it anymore. That is the PC Perspective March Madness contest. I don't think anybody from our staff actually signed up. Did you sign up at all, Josh?
Are you kidding? I hate basketball.
Oh, well, that's not very nice of you.
No, that's why I make fun of you all the time when you talk about how great UK is. And I say, what, United Kingdom? And you get cranky and angry. And then I start asking if you want some tea and crumpets at the cricket match. And then things just go downhill from there.
I don't think you should be that harsh on cricket.
Oh, I learned to play cricket a couple of weeks ago, and it's very
You're still odd. Playing the game, aren't you?
It's very odd. We actually had like 80 people sign up. What I wanted to do here was just briefly go over, for those people, I imagine many of them are listening to the podcast that also signed up. We have Matt Lehigh in first, Stuart Britton in second, ironically enough, based on Josh's comment. Alan Tong, David Albin, Pellegrino Spagnuolo. These are some of the top people in line to win magnificent prizes. I'm actually 18th, so I don't know what that means necessarily about my ability to pick college basketball picks. But that's a quick update on where we are with that. Hopefully your name is read as one of the top contestants. If not, sorry, better luck next time. Now, let's jump into some content. The first thing, last week or 2 weeks ago, I don't know when it was, you guys can remind me, we talked about this card. Radeon HD 69.
Two long weeks ago and last week.
Yeah, yep. Okay.
You just can't get enough of that card, can you? It's big, it's black, it's long, it's got a fan in the middle, which makes no sense. But
yeah, that makes it very odd from what you were going for. I didn't talk about the overclocking kind of results that I got out of it yet, though. That was something that I didn't have time to test before launch. There was this little tiny switch at the top. I won't bother trying to show it on camera, even on the close-up, because it's really, really tiny. If you remember on the 68 and 6900 cards, there was a switch that would allow you to revert back to the original BIOS if you would happen to flash the first BIOS to a setting that was too high, kind of corrupted it, it was too hot, wouldn't boot anymore. You could switch the switch back, revert back to the original BIOS, so it would flash it over, and you'd be able to start over. It's a pretty cool little thing. But not a whole lot of people are doing flashing of their own graphics cards, so it wasn't probably utilized as often as it could have been. On the 6990, they went a different route, and the switch actually enables an overclocking mode. So rather than having one part of the switch just revert to the original BIOS, it actually overclocks it. It moves the default clock speed from 830 to 880 megahertz. It moves the default voltage from 1.12 to 1.175 volts, and it also increases the power tune flexibility of the hardware, moves it from 375 watts maximum power draw to 450 watts maximum power draw, which is a pretty significant difference. Now, at the overclock settings, if you go to the article, you'll see I ran some benchmarks at 2560 by 1600 just to kind of show you what difference you'll see going from the 830 megahertz to the 880 megahertz clock speed. It was kind of what you would expect for a modest 50 megahertz clock increase. You know, we're only talking, what, 7 or 8% difference. So the gains were noticeable, probably not noticeable like in terms of actual gameplay if you were to sit down and do it. But What's interesting is when you increase the voltage and you increase the maximum power draw of the card, the idea here is that, well, you should be able to get more overclocking headroom out of it with the switch in that setting. So I did some overclocking with it as well, above and beyond the 880. And the highest I was able to reach in a stable environment, running loops of games for, you know, an hour or more without any problems, was 950 megahertz on the clock speed there. So that's an increase of, what, let's see, 8% total over the 880. And then...
See, that's that UK 15%. Math education coming to your aid.
Right. Or it's the calculator app opening up on my laptop, one or the other. So that's 950 megahertz is about 15% higher than the stock 830. So you get a decent performance boost out of that, if nothing else. Power consumption did increase quite a bit as well. Even moving just from 830 to 880, if we looked at the power consumption numbers, it went from 491 watts, again, total system, not just for the graphics card, 491 to 554. So an increase of, what is that, 63 watts of power just from flipping the switch and going from 830 to 880 megahertz. That's pretty dramatic. Obviously, this is kind of why AMD capped the frequency where they did. It's why they capped the power tune at 375 watts, because they knew going much over 830, going over 830 would result in these larger than standard spikes in power consumption. Overall, my kind of conclusion here was, if you buy a 6990, is it worth flipping the switch, so to speak, from 830 to 880 and then overclocking more, or would you just keep it at the 830 megahertz clock rate? And I seem to think that from my personal perspective, I would more or less just kind of leave it alone. I also noticed there were some that the fan noise was high. You were running in the overclocked settings with the higher power consumption. That kind of stuff. Fan speed got a little higher, a little bit noisier there. And performance was better, but not a whole lot better. We're already talking about the fastest graphics card you can buy, period, right? So it's hard to want a whole lot more unless you're running triple 30-inch monitors or something like that, or six 24-inch monitors, something crazy and out there like that. I really think that the Switch is kind of more for the LM2 overclockers, those guys that are going to really push things. They want to break records. They want to do things like that. But I was just curious if you guys had any thoughts on viability of the Switch like this. Is it a good thing to see on there? My conclusion was I wouldn't use it, but I'm glad to see AMD supporting the enthusiast crowd with this level of commitment.
That's what I did with my 6950. Oh. Yeah, it's not that it came pre-overclocked, but it is that my Switch is essentially now default 6950 or flash to 6970. You know, it wasn't the exact original intent of the dual BIOS, right, but it's exactly what I'm using it for, as an overclocking switch. Not that I'm turning it back anytime soon.
Yeah. Josh, what were you going to say?
You know, I think it's great. I think it's nice that they're giving users that kind of ability, and it's free. If they want that extra 1.5% performance, they can flip that switch and you know, cause an extra 60 watts of power drain or whatever it was that you measured. But no, it's great. I mean, it gives users the feeling of power, that they can choose their own destiny, going with Switch A or Switch B. So it's a good thing.
I agree. So, again, this we're talking about a $700 graphics card here. NVIDIA put a teaser out earlier in the week, by the way. We'll talk about it a little bit later. So if you're thinking about buying the 6990, it's probably beneficial for you to just wait a little bit, maybe less than 12 hours from this recording, something like that, just to make sure you're going to buy the right one. You know, it may not change your mind either way, but it's always better to have as much information as possible before you spend, especially this type of money, on a graphics card. Speaking of graphics cards, and in this case, another AMD one, Josh, you just published a review of an MSI HD 6950 with the twin Frozr 2 cooler on it. What are your general thoughts on this? We kind of talked about 6990. Jeremy mentioned his 6950 and was able to flash it over to a 6970. I don't think we did anything like that in this review. What was your overall impressions of, like, the custom cooler? Did it come overclocked out of the box, I assume, and general performance, that kind of stuff?
Well, you know, it just all sucks. Everything just sucks. Wait, I need some more Prozac.
We're not talking about your life. We're talking about graphics cards.
You know, this is a pretty good card. Now, you know, last year around this time, I had my first twin Frozr experience with the HD 5770. And I was pretty impressed by the card. It wasn't all that much more expensive than a reference design of the 5770. It performed around the same as a HD 4870 of the previous generation, but you were able to add in the extra oomph of DirectX 11. It had good DirectX 11 support. It had a lot of good things going for it. I mean, it could overclock pretty well. It didn't pull all that much more power. It was a good product. And then on the other side, we had the HD 5870 Lightning, which was kind of a bad product from MSI. And, you know, they had this custom PCB, they had this heavy-duty cooling, and it just didn't overclock worth a damn. It was extra money that was just seriously not worth it. And now we've got the HD 6950 Twin Frozr 2. Now the Twin Frozr 2, it's the second generation of the Twin Frozr cooler. It's got two 80-millimeter fans, two of them going like this, counterclockwise, clockwise, whatever you feel like.
Right.
And don't bother with the phone because it's not for you. But anyway, it's the second generation of that. It's got a copper plate in there like the first one did. It's nickel plated. It's got five heat pipes in there, two of which are 8-millimeter super pipes.
Super pipes.
And, you know, I think that most testing has seen that at the highest level of GPU usage, at speeds of fans which will not tear your eardrums out, it's about 6 centigrade cooler than the reference setup. So when we're talking actually cooling performance, the fans, they don't sound real loud. They work pretty well. Again, they keep it cool. Even when overclocked, this thing never really got above 76 degrees Celsius, which is pretty damn good when we're talking about other cards that you have seen and you have tested and I have seen and tested that go well into the 90 degrees area.
Yes.
And sound like freaking hair dryers. And so this was a very, very positive thing. The card also is overclocked slightly. It goes from 800 megahertz to 810 megahertz. It doesn't overclock the memory at all. So yeah, it is an overclock card, but it's pretty kind pathetic. Yeah, if you were just to use the AMD Overdrive, you could take it up to 840 megahertz core and I believe 1325 memory, which would give you a nice little boost. And at that speed, it does slightly overtake the older GTX 480 card. But if you decide to use the MSI Afterburner application, which is actually a really, really, really nice overclocking application designed by the folks at Revertuner, you do some magic in the config file. You type in some words, and you set a 0 to 1. In one of the other settings, and next thing you know, you're going up to 935 megahertz. I know in my sample, it wasn't happy over 932 megahertz, but once you hit that spot, you had performance that was about 2 or 3% faster than the GTX 480. Now, that's kind of important because the GTX 480 is about the same speed as the GTX 570, which retails for around, let's say, what, $349 on
which
special?
Which card? The 570?
Yeah.
Yeah, $349.
Yeah. And so with the new Catalyst 11.4 preview drivers, which have a totally redone compiler that will really help the performance of the new Cayman chips, which use a VEC4 type processing system rather than the old VEC 5 that the HD 5000 series had. You know, we're seeing a $260 card get real close or outperform a $349 card from NVIDIA. So this is a really, really, really nice thing. And MSI has done a good job with this card. I mean, it's well built. You know, it has a nice amount of overclocking to it. The cooler is fantastic. I mean, I decided to do some extended testing in my main machine with this card to see how well it does. And so far, I've been ecstatic about it. Some of the areas that I'm really happy about is, yes, it's got the increased geometry performance. It's got better tessellation performance than the last generation. But the one thing that really sold me on it was the coverage sample AA that they finally introduced into the AMD line. Now, NVIDIA's had this for the past couple of years, and it was one of the areas where I think that NVIDIA really had an advantage. And when you do the CSAA as well as the improvements in the anisotropic filtering, this really is a very competitive card with what NVIDIA has. And you can get it for, you know, 15% less or 30% less than what NVIDIA charges. So it's got 2 gigs of memory on it, which if you go back 10 years ago and you just count up all of your hard drives and everything, you could barely get to 2 gigs. It's a fantastic card. Got plenty of bandwidth. It's got all the features you need. It's got the UVD3 functionality. And MSI has built a nice little card. Now, the only problem with this card, it's a little bit more expensive than a reference model. And the other problem is it doesn't have that bio switch that Jeremy was talking about. So you can't do, you know, the AB bio switch.
Huh, plus, I didn't know that. Okay.
You can't even flash it to a 6970 BIOS that Jeremy has done to make it that much faster. So those are some bummer parts about it. But, you know, I really question whether a lot of the upcoming reference boards that we're going to see are going to have that functionality. Not so much the BIOS switch,
right?
But being able to flash to a 6970 and be able to get those performance increases. So that is a downside. It's a possibility. The majority of users out there who buy this card probably will not flash it. I mean, how many people are really truly comfortable with that? Maybe 10 or 15%. But, you know, otherwise, this was a pretty tremendous card. It didn't cost a huge amount. It plays everything that I've been using at it with aplomb. It even ran Crysis 2 without a problem.
Wow. That's amazing.
Unbelievable.
Well, anyway, that's going to be way worse than Crysis 1, right?
Yeah, something like that. I've got to reload Crysis 1 and check it out. And
you know, it would still be a better benchmark.
Yeah. But anyway, you know, it was a good card. MSI made a good product. It's priced decently for what you get. And, you know, they've had some recent price reductions that now you can get this for about $274 after rebate. So that allowed me to give it an Editor's Choice Award. I mean, it's not a silver or a gold. It's not really a breakthrough product like others that I have seen, but it's still pretty good. So, you know, I gave it that. And, you know, I would recommend it. I think it's a good card, and certainly it's quiet, it runs cool, and it's pretty nice for most users. So there you have it.
All right. Before we move on to some more super exciting news and information, we will take a quick break to thank today's podcast sponsor. All right, thank you for that. We're going to get to a couple of news bits here. I don't know if we lost Alan or if he's just not answering in the chat at all. Alan, are you there?
What? Chat?
Yes, exactly. Chat. In the chat window. I was wondering if you had anything. Alan, do you have anything you would like to discuss with us? You just want us to move right on?
No, I'll just move right on. I should open the chat, though, so I'll do that right now.
He said what? In the...
I knew we had a review in the pipeline. I'm not sure if you wanted to discuss it or if you want to save that for next week.
Not ready yet. Next week.
Okay.
There'll be a whole lot next week.
There should be a lot from Alan next week. So if you're a big fan of Alan, first of all, what's wrong with you? Second of all, tune in next week's podcast. Expect a lot there. We're going to jump into some news items here. Jeremy, why don't you tell us a little bit about NVIDIA's box?
Well, they stuck something in it, and they really want to show it to you, but they're not quite ready yet. But come 6 o'clock Pacific, 9 o'clock a.m. tomorrow morning, there will be a new teaser trailer up, which is going to show you what is in this nice little ammo box labeled Top Secret, because this is the year of war in computer components.
Apparently.
Every single manufacturer is going for this. And
why couldn't I own my own website where they'd send me this stuff? I mean, seriously.
Do you want to see what's in it, really?
No.
It's packing peanuts.
Does it have a mouse in it? How about a mouse pad?
It's packing peanuts. Mouse pad.
The world's fastest packing peanuts.
Packed with nuts, that really doesn't satisfy.
The box is packed with nuts. It also came with the dog tags I showed everybody last week as well, and I don't think they liked that, but hey, it happens.
And for some bizarre reason, they want to show off the how incredible this thing is going to be by putting Crysis 2 in the background, which, as most people I'm sure have encountered by now, really isn't going to stress your hardware.
Hey, look, all I'm saying is it will do something. It will stress it.
And, it's on one monitor.
Well, maybe we'll talk about this at the end.
Hey, if you had a wall,
Tom's looking quite dashing in that video capture.
Isn't he? He was very proud when he sent that video out. And so basically the video just says, hey, we have a new project. Wink, wink. It's probably the GTX 590. Wink, wink. And it will be taking the lid off of it at 9 a.m. tomorrow, which means if you're listening to this live, make sure you come back to PC Perspective at 9 a.m. tomorrow Eastern, 6 a.m. Pacific, to get all the wonderful news about the top secret project that NVIDIA has. If you're listening to this, you've downloaded it. If this is after the fact, then it's already out and you should have already read it 10 times. At least 10 times, because there's a quiz at the end of the week. Just a thought. Let's see what else we got here. A surprise Bulldozer sneak peek at the unreleased AMD processors. Now, this is a news post that Jeremy put up, but it links to Foronix, I guess is the name of that site. And, Josh, you looked over some of their benchmarks. These are engineering samples of Bulldozer processors. I'm not sure if this is an AMD-condoned or not process. What kind of interesting information were you able to glean from this preview?
Well, if we're looking at just true threaded performance, a 16-thread AMD Bulldozer versus a 12-thread Intel i7 processor at around the same clock speed, you're looking at about a 25 to 30% increase in performance on the AMD side, which is a big jump for them. I mean, if you see that their 6-core processors are barely keeping up with the i7-800 series that are 4-core processors, you know that this is a huge jump for them. So this is, unfortunately, a very specialized application, which will be very, very multi-threaded. So we don't have any idea what, you know, IPC is going to be for these Bulldozers are. But this first little salvo that's been released looks very promising for AMD, especially when we're talking about multi-thread type performance. And, you know, it's a good teaser, and it's exciting. And it's nice to know that they do have 16 core, which is 8 module performance products running at 1.8 gigahertz in the engineering sampling phase and running very, very well. So there's a lot of hope for Bulldozer, and from what we've seen, it's not all hype. And if you ever kind of look back at AMD and what they do, they've always done a lot by, you know, hiding their strength behind their hand and really kind of pounding it to it. I mean, if we looked at the original Phenom, they were talking it up all the way to the moon and back, saying how wonderful it was going to be. It was this monolithic quad core, and it was just going to beat everything under the sun, and it didn't. And now we don't hear anything about Bulldozer and its performance other than it's going to be, you know, comparable. It's next generation. It's something that, you know, we're happy about, but they're not talking it up like they have in previous generations that have kind of fallen on their face. So this may be a good thing, and that's not my banging
around. Oh, that was
around.
The audio for someone falling on their face.
Yes,
brilliantly
it
timed,
was.
I must say.
Tremendous. Yeah. Was that
but there's
Alan?
A certain vociferous... Drinking?
That was me playing with my comments.
Good Lord, George. Man. This is a family show.
I was just going to say, there's a certain vociferous tech reporter that's going to be very happy that all of these benchmarks are run on a Linux platform.
Is it me? I don't think it's me.
No. No, semi-accurate. No, somebody who hammered Sandy Bridge for not being Linux compatible because it doesn't have a graphics driver.
Oh, yeah, that guy. Gotcha.
Yeah.
I know him.
Gotcha.
You know what's not good news? I don't know. That was a bad segue. How about if you're Intel, getting rid of the senior vice president in charge of your ultra mobility group, a.k.a. The group that was supposed to be able to compete against ARM? Anand
Chandracksara.
Gosh, I'm really awful at that. I apologize. So apparently he got canned, right, Josh? So what's up with that?
Well, you know, he left on his own, apparently, to pursue other outside interests.
That's what we're going to tell people when you leave, right?
Except I have no other interests except beer, and so...
He's left to pursue beer, so there you go.
I'm a drunk and an alcoholic, and you'll find me at the shelter on 5th and Grand in Laramie.
Anyway, sorry. Back to the Intel story.
Yeah, I mean, this guy has been at Intel for 24 years. And if you know anything about Intel's hiring and retaining practices, it's a tough place to work. I mean, the best and the brightest go there to work, and they last an average of 7 years. You get some of the really outstanding examples of people like Ottolini and Chandracksara, whatever his name is. I mean, these guys were the shining stars of Intel. I mean, they surpassed all expectations. They got through all the politics. They got through all the cullings. And they rose to the top, and they did that because they were aggressive. They were smart. They had a very good vision for what Intel could be, and certainly they were able to get there. Now, when a guy of this stature leaves – it's kind of a big thing. I mean, if you remember a couple of years back, Intel got rid of its ARM section. I believe they sold them to Infineon. I can't remember exactly. They kind of just totally bailed ship on the low-voltage, low-wattage processors. And in hindsight, I mean, that was the biggest mistake they did. They didn't have the engineering group that would be able to tackle a lot of these low-power applications that right now are just, you know, blossoming. I mean, we're talking about a billion processors being shipped out this year in the mobile space in terms right. of cell phones, tablets, other internet devices, refrigerators, washing machines, whatever, they're going to be armed with these ARM processors, and Intel has missed out on a big chunk of this. And, when you've got NVIDIA moving forward with, hey, we're going to make these high-powered, high-performance ARM-based processors, and there's no reason why we can't do that with this type of architecture, I mean, Intel they're looking back and they're thinking, what in the hell did we do? Why did we get rid of this group? And I think that, they tried to shoehorn Atom in there. While Atom is a decent product, it's not great. And certainly when you compare it to AMD's Bobcat, it really shows a lot of the issues that it has, both in graphics and in IPC and just the overall architecture. And, you're thinking that Intel should have been able to foresee this. I mean, these are the guys who brought out the Core 2 parts that just absolutely destroyed everything else on the market. They had the i7, which, it matched AMD in terms of transistor count, but just totally spanked it in terms of performance and power. And then we look at their Atom, and it's just it hasn't worked out as well as it has, as they wanted it to. And I think that perhaps part of that is they were not forward-looking enough. Perhaps they tried too hard to get a product in there that just was not right. I mean, we look at the differences in processor design with the Atom and the AMD Bobcat, and I mean, we see two totally different trains of thought. I mean, the Atom is essentially, you know, a Pentium MMX. It's in order. It's not that complex. And then we look at right. the AMD side with Bobcat. And it's a really, really interesting mix of power and performance and, you know, kind of next-generation features that really has set it apart from the pack. And I mean, how many, you know, design wins has Bobcat gotten? And how many companies are introducing tablets and netbooks that are based on this processor and motherboards and low-powered systems, because it really was a disruptive technology for the time. And all of this is done on a TSMC 40-nanometer process. So, yeah, Anand leaving Intel is a really big thing. He was a mover and shaker, and he was mm-hmm. you know, one of the bright lights of the entire company. And for him to just take off and go on to something else, I mean, it's kind of a big deal.
You know,
not
Josh,
the downfall mind, but it's a big deal.
You're one of the shining stars of this company.
Well, only because of my forehead. Look how bright that particular star is.
That is very shiny. You're right. No doubt there. Also in the news this week, PCMark 7 FutureMark, based in Helsinki, Finland. Developer of the world's most popular benchmarking software announced PCMark 7 a couple days ago, a new benchmark offering complete PC performance analysis for Windows 7. Jeremy, how much more do we know about PCMark 7 than that?
It's got a really nice logo.
Cool.
Really, there's not very much. You can follow them on Facebook if you'd really like to. But, you know, as far as actual hands-on, we don't know. What they're saying is one of the big things that they've redone this for is solid-state drives. There's not really been a benchmarking tool with PCMark or 3DMark or anything that really actually takes advantage of, hey, let's thrash your SSD to see exactly what it can do.
Right.
Especially when you're looking at your netbooks and your tablets and that, which are, you know, the better ones are shipping with a little SSD. Right. The new cloud-based one from Google with the, not the Android, but their other OS is, but it's shipping with an SSD. So they've sort of said, you know, this is something we really need to look at being able to benchmark.
Sure.
And honestly, without learning Iometer or a lot of the other benchmarking suites, this is sort of a nice way to push a button and get a number at the end that you can compare with other people.
Yep.
Yeah, they say, and we'll see what that number actually means.
True.
Right. They do talk about in here the PCMark 7 will include more than 20 individual workloads covering storage, computation, image and video manipulation, web browsing and gaming, blah, 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 blah. They're going to offer a separate lightweight suite, measures capabilities of entry-level systems and mobility platforms unable to run the entire PCMark suite. Yeah, and all the stuff Jeremy said about storage and SSD and even external hard drives as well. So they announced it. They say coming soon. They didn't announce anything about pricing. They didn't announce anything about availability, like when soon kind of is at all. Not really sure the need to kind of come out and make this announcement other than coming soon.
You know? Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Soon. So there you go. That's pretty much the roundup of news for the week. Not a whole lot, like I said. Next week, we will be very busy. We've got GPUs. We've got SSDs. We've got Josh and Jeremy. Those are categories of things all known.
You want to buy quickly. Wait, no. Stop.
The next thing we're going to dive into here are voicemails. We've got four voicemails, three of which will actually have audio. One of them was kind of a garbled audio file, so I'll kind of read over what he wanted to know, and we've got a couple emails that we'll get to. So, Burke, if you are ready and have this queued up, let's go ahead and take voicemail numero one.
Hey, PC Per Crew. Just a quick question about new AM3 motherboards, or AM3 Plus motherboards, sorry. it seems like it's been forever. I've always heard that it's going to be a March or April release. You guys heard anything? I really, 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 really want an AM3 Plus motherboard so that I could just upgrade to Bulldozer later on this year. Just give me a heads up on the next episode or whatever. Love the podcast. Thanks. It's Josh, by the way.
Thank you, Josh.
Josh. Yeah.
Availability. That is the key question, Burke. This is something, you know, especially when AMD started that marketing campaign. Ready, willing, and stable. It's one of the things we talked about was like, you know, this would be a much more effective campaign, much easier to target this enthusiast crowd if they had these AM3 Plus motherboards. And why are these AM3 Plus motherboards important, Josh?
Well, you know, AM3 Plus is important because I'm trying to find a link, but
it'll support Bulldozer is the answer.
They'll support Bulldozer, and not only that, but they'll support current AM3 motherboards. Now, up in Canada, that I knew for sure, Gigabyte had actually offered a AMD 800 series motherboard, but it had the black AM3 socket. And I'm trying to see if they are available in the U.S. And so far, it does not look to be the case. But
Canadians got it first?
Pardon?
Did you say Canadians?
Canada got it first. Yeah, I don't understand why. But it was an 870A-based chipset. And sure enough, it had the black AM3 socket on there. If you go onto Gigabyte's website, they have all of these AM3-based boards that are already there, and it's not even released officially by AMD. So we really are on the cusp of these. I would say within a month and a half, we're going to have the motherboards not just on the 800 series side, but probably the 900 series side. I'm not under NDA yet. I haven't heard any official news, so I can talk about this. But yeah, I mean, Gigabyte is, you know, they're certainly looking like they're being a bit more aggressive than the other manufacturers, and we should probably be seeing them soon.
Do you think it's worth waiting for that product? I mean, that was kind of like our premise, I guess, a few weeks ago. So I'd imagine that's still kind of the case.
You know, I would. I mean, if you can handle another month and a half of your current system, You might as well do it. I mean, you can get an absolute dirt cheap Athlon 2, whether it's dual core, tri core, or quad core, and you could be happy with that performance for quite some time. And then, you know, once Bulldozer's prices go down a little bit and they have a larger selection of them, then just, you know, buy one of those and pop it in and just be ecstatic about what you're getting. Because you're getting next generation technology.
Next generation. There you go. Let's queue up our second voicemail here that more or less targets Alan.
Gentlemen, love the podcast. I think you need to revisit the topic of SSDs and secure erasing. Most people just want to secure delete a file, not the whole drive, especially in today's atmosphere of going through customs and having your stuff possibly inspected. So I think the coverage of the topic in the last show should have been delved into a little bit more. Another thing, Al, if you could, can you go into SSDs and TrueCrypt? Just how badly is the performance drop, or am I destroying the drive by using TrueCrypt? I know because it's not a rotating platter that there are some considerations in using TrueCrypt. Should we use it? And how bad is the performance hit? Or are we going to kill it? All right, thanks a lot, guys. Take care. Bye-bye.
So, Alan, what do I do with my animal porn when I'm going through the airport?
Okay, so for secure erase, for individual files, the deal here is if you overwrite a file on a solid-state drive with the regular, okay, I'm trying to secure erase file thing, same thing that you would use on a regular hard drive, even though the file might still, like bits and pieces of it might still be present on the chips themselves, you're not going to be able to access it the regular way anymore. In other words, once you've overwritten it, it's gone as far as talking to the drive through the actual port on the drive, like the regular way, like with forensic software, whatever you might use, right?
Gotcha.
It's gone. Okay? And it's not coming back. for all intents and purposes.
If you, that's good,
on the other hand, have some really specialized gear that can grab the actual flash chip contents of the drive, and you have to really know what the heck you're doing to even decipher what is where on that, to the point where I'm pretty sure there might be 10 organizations or companies, period, like on the planet right now that can do that. And half of them are like the people making the drives. So if you're going through an airport and they look at your drive, these people are not going to dissect it and pull flash chips off of it and figure out what had been deleted a month ago and just hadn't been overwritten on the flash just by the, you know, by the wear leveling or whatnot.
Right.
So, yeah, it's pretty much gone, right? But just realize that, yes, technically it is in there somewhere, but it's just extremely hard to get to. At this point, it's probably about as hard as it is to get to if it was on an actual spinning disk and you overrode it. And, you know, yes, there are ways to go in there and dive in and look and see if one track was written just a little bit offset from the previous one or from the previous layer, and then you can actually get that data back. It's probably about that hard right now, technically speaking. Now, separate thing, TrueCrypt on solid-state drives. Yes, it does more wear on the drive. It only does it because it's about the same as if you were running that same SSD under Windows XP or some OS that didn't have trim. Basically, if you took an SSD and you did one complete write pass to it, you just wrote it front to back. So in other words, you had actually touched every single LBA on that drive and written to it at least once. And then from that point forward, realized that the drive would perform a little bit less, right, because now you've used up all those spaces. So now every time you write to something, you're guaranteeing it has to play musical chairs with that chunk of data, has to move it somewhere else when
right.
It's filling the new hole, right? That performance dip you will see when you TrueCrypt the entire drive. Same kind of performance dip, right, because now you've written to the entire drive. The only difference is you've written encrypted data to the whole drive as opposed to just writing a bunch of zeros to it. Okay, the drive doesn't care what kind of data it is. It's oblivious to that. So the only real performance drops you'll see there is the fact that you can't use trim, right? Trim's not going to work. So really, it's as if you were just running an SSD under a non-trim compatible OS, and you had taken that SSD and written to the entire thing, like filled it up to capacity before you started using it. So you're going to basically get the almost worst case write performance, but realize that's still not very bad for an SSD. Especially for some of the decent, more decent ones like Intel, even SandForce are still pretty decent once you filled them up all the way.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, it's going to wear faster because you don't have trim cleaning up all those areas that are actually empty. You don't have as much extra free room to work with as far as the flash memory goes. So you're guaranteeing every single write's going to be shuffling more data around than normally would. But still, it's not going to, you know, blow the SSD up or anything crazy like that. It's just going to wear it a little bit quicker. If you're a regular average Joe user, but maybe even power user enough to the point where, yes, you are one of those people TrueCrypting your drive, an SSD is still going to be able to hack it just fine. It's, you know, it might go from 5-year typical lifespan to down to like 4 or something like that, just depending on what you do.
All right. Is it, yep. I mean, 5 to 4 years. Now, when you say 4 years, you might be worrying some people because, like, okay, I might have my SSD for 4 years. Is it going to die in 4 years, or is it, does
here's how SSDs will normally fail due to wear, due to, like, use. They just won't be able to write anymore. They'll eventually hit a point where all those slack space, all those extra flash blocks that were sort of built in as overhead when it was manufactured, it'll use them all up, and then it'll eventually get to the point where it's like, oh, I got no spare anymore. Okay. And basically they just shut the write ability off. So every time you go to do a write to that drive, it just times out. But that doesn't stop you from being able to still mount the volume, read only, of course, and just pull all the data right off. The only time that doesn't happen is if the controller itself fails, but that's just a separate, that has nothing to do with the wear of the drive and how much you've written to it. That's just if a chip's going to fail, it's going to fail. Kind of thing.
Somebody asked in the chat room, is there a way to monitor how many of those spare blocks are left?
That's not black and white enough to be able to say and put like a temperature gauge on it or like a percentage. You have this percentage left kind of thing.
Right.
Yeah, there's some ways to read the smart data on drives where you can get certain parameters back as far as bad blocks mapped out, that sort of thing. I think the first or second Intel X25M 80 gig piece that I wrote, I went into that and actually it might have been the 160 gig drive, where I actually deciphered some of the smart data. I actually had to get some data from like the Intel engineers back to figure out, okay, what does this number mean? And it was like, if the number incremented by one, then it meant that there were four blocks worth of flash mapped out. But for any given drive, there's just so many different variables there that unless the manufacturer just flat out tells you, okay, this is 50% of it, or this is 100% of the spare area of the drive, which none of them have really done. Even Intel, which has been one of the companies to give me the most info, I still couldn't tell you like how much life there is left on my original drive that I bought.
Huh. Interesting. Disappointing.
Yeah, it's too vague right now.
Yeah. Let's see. We got a third voicemail in from a listener in China who I apologize name I could not repeat. Also, it seemed like the voice over IP connection was a little garbly type of thing. So rather than play the audio back and have everybody try to decipher it, I just figured I'd get to the meat of the question. He was actually a user who was buying a Core i3 2300, did not have plans to use any discrete graphics card because he's actually blind. So he wasn't going to game, wasn't going to do that kind of stuff. However, because of the cost of power over there, that kind of thing, he wanted a very efficient power supply. Any recommendations? And he wanted to know if 300 watts would be enough for that system. Now, we don't have a whole lot of other details about the system other than the processor, but I'm assuming Core i3 processor, no discrete graphics card, maybe let's go with one optical drive, two hard drives, mini ITX, or mini micro ATX style motherboard, even a full-size motherboard, that type of thing. Would we consider 300 watts to be enough? I don't know if I would consider that. It probably would be, considering how much Intel is pushing the energy efficiency of the Sandy Bridge processors. 300 watts would be enough, as long as you buy what most of us would consider like a higher quality product, something that is going to be more reliable and actually give you strong amperage and that kind of stuff at that 300-watt range. Now, I started looking around a little bit here. If we look at, let's see, Corsair is a good brand. PC Power and Cooling is a good brand. I was trying to see kind of where these start at.
I really couldn't find anything better than the Corsair Builder CX500, which is actually a 450-watt. But it was it was $57 at the time I saw it. You're not really going to find a solid 300 watt for much cheaper than that. At least I've never seen one.
Right. I'm sure they exist, but they're a lot harder to find. And the thing is, if you get a higher quality unit that's like this Builder Series CX400 that I see on the Corsair website is 80 plus certified. That it's going to be efficient. So even if you're not using 400 watts, it's not like it's going to be drawing much more power than a 300-watt power supply would at 150 watts or whatever the maximum power consumption is going to be. So that's kind of like you don't have to worry about getting one that's too much unless it's like a cost issue, right? But just because you get a power supply that's 500 watts doesn't mean it's going to be pulling 500 watts the whole time. And if you get one that is built well and is efficient, it won't use more power at 150 watts than, say, a 300-watt power supply would at 150 watts. Is that right? I mean, does that make sense to everybody?
Yeah.
Okay. Sure.
Sure, why not? Yeah. All right, we do have one. Something else? No?
No. No, I was all just right, opening a beer.
Of course you were. Of course. No, that's fine. Let's do one more voicemail. We've got one more voicemail here about 6990 graphics card.
Hey guys, Juan Carlos calling from San Diego. Just wanted to get your opinion on something. I'm going to spend at least $800 building a new rig, and I just saw that you dropped the HD 6990 review on your website. I wanted to see what you think I should do. I have a quad-core 6700, 4 gigs of DDR2, 1066 RAM. I was thinking of redoing the whole system and putting in like a i7 2600K, and the P67 or the chipset they're after, whichever Intel puts out, and a 6952 gig card, or should I just get a 6990 and put that in there versus redoing the whole system? I don't know if my Q6700 would be a bottleneck or my RAM, which is easily upgradable. If you can just give me some advice on that, greatly appreciate it. And love the show. It's one of my two favorite shows. First one's, well, the other one's Bassmasters.
Fishing show. All right.
Bassmasters.
That's Josh's second favorite podcast, too.
Can't help it.
So this question is basically saying, I have $800 to spend on a computer upgrade. He's got a Q6700. Do I want to spend it all on a Radeon HD 6990? Or do I want to get, what did he say, a 6950 and a newer processor and motherboard combo or something like that? That was pretty much the collection there.
Yeah.
So what do you guys think?
I would say go with 6950 and another monitor.
Okay.
Even two. All right.
I guess he needs to take a real good look at his actual usage and see where that money's going to best go. I mean, if he's playing 3D games at high resolutions, at multi-monitors, then yeah, the 6990 would be the way to go. If he just does single monitor performance at 1920 by 1200 or 1080p, then maybe he'd be better off with a processor, motherboard, memory, and like a 6950. I mean, those should get him by for most things. But, right. Yeah, I mean, the 6990 is really for folks who running a 30-inch monitor, who wants to do multi-monitors with a single card and have Infinity. So, yeah, we're at the point where, unlike a couple of years back when you just say, oh, yeah, just get the highest-end graphics card, you'll be happy. You know, we really got to balance around different system performance depending on what they do. I mean, if they do a lot of video encoding, a lot of transcoding, stuff like that, you know, getting a new processor might help him out. You know, get a few minutes off of each encode. And if he's only using a single monitor, then, you know, a 6950 or an 8, or GTX 570, it's going to be more than enough for most 1080p and whatnot type applications.
Yeah, I mean, he was asking, is the CPU going to be the bottleneck on this card? Maybe not all the time, but definitely some of the time. And I really don't want to recommend a card that's $700 to somebody that maybe has $800 every couple of years to spend on their system. As much as AMD would love me to say that they would like to do that, because I'm sure this is a high profit margin part. You know, I really would subscribe more to the theory that, you know, these $700 graphics cards are more for those people that are willing to spend $3,000 on a computer and are comfortable with that, you know, on a yearly, biannual type basis. $800, if that's your PC upgrade cost for 24 months, then I think your 6950 plus CPU and motherboard is good. Jeremy's option of going with multiple displays is one of those things that very few people think of until after they've already spent all of their money on other components is a good option too. Plus, Alan would be mad if we didn't say SSDs as well.
SSDs.
There. Now it has been said. Let's. So that was our voicemail.
Facebook now.
1-888-38-PC-PER is the email, or not the email address. Wow, that's the phone number for us. podcast@pcper.com is the email address. And we do have two emails we're going to get to. I'll take the first one here. It comes from Rick. He basically pointed us to, well, that's the completely wrong link that I put in there. But there was a spec sheet on the, remember last week we talked about the EVGA GeForce GTX 460 2-win? Remember that card?
Mm-hmm.
This was a pair of GTX 460 GPUs on a single graphics card, or on a single PCB. And this is unique to EVGA. It's not like an NVIDIA reference design type product. So that's unique. I think last week we talked about it. We didn't know what the price was. Now we know the price, and it's available for purchase. It's $429. which is interesting because that puts it about $30, no, $50, $50 to $70 less than the GeForce GTX 580. And if we looked at the performance numbers that EVGA had, at least, it put the performance just ahead of the 580 in 3D Mark 11 and 3D Mark Vantage, I think. And this graphics card has three dual-link DVI outputs, allows you to do NVIDIA Surround or 3D Vision Surround, plus it has a mini HDMI connection. So this card supports four monitors, NVIDIA Surround on a single graphics card. It's a little bit faster than the GTX 580. It's going to cost $50 to $70 less than the GTX 580. Now all of a sudden this card is a lot more appealing, I think, because I was afraid it was going to come out at, you know, $550 or $599 because it's kind of a custom design. So I'm wondering, is this a card we should consider? I realize this is kind of a vague question because we haven't done a review of it. We haven't actually tested these benchmarks and seen that kind of stuff. But we can really take a pretty good guess at performance because we are so familiar with the GTX 460 1GB cards. And we, you know, we'd be able to call them if their 1GB SLI numbers were somehow wildly different than what we saw. So we kind of know what performance to expect. And if these features work, three displays, the four simultaneous displays and the three displays surround, does that make this a viable card all of a sudden, or are you kind of pushed away by the 400 series reference? This is where this is a back and forth. Another people Lord. Talk.
Are you talking to me?
Yeah, sure. Why not?
I wasn't even listening. I was talking on IRC. Next thing I know, there's all this silence and people looking at me, and it's awful. It's like my third wife when she asked for pearls and crap.
Do you think this card will be attractive at $429, Josh?
Which card was that?
The one we've been talking about for a couple minutes. GeForce GTX 462. No.
Wait,
no.
No.
We moved on.
GTX. Oh, that yeah. one. That monster.
The GTX 460 to lose.
Yeah, that's, that's a decent balance, and actually, for performance and price and what you're getting with multi-monitors. And so, it depends on how well it's implemented in the drivers that NVIDIA is able to provide. And
it should work fine, right? It's just SLI in a card. SLI works great on NVIDIA's products.
It's going to be faster in games that have SLI than a GTX 580. But you don't always get the great scaling. So,
true.
Boy, that's that's a tough question because it has advantages and disadvantages to it. The nicest thing, of course, is the ability to power three monitors and have the NVIDIA Surround. I don't know.
I think it makes a case. I'll be curious about two things. Will they make enough of these cards for it to be like a long-term solution? Is this something that's going to, they're going to sell out in 5-6 weeks anyway, so they're not going to bother to send out review samples and that type of thing. We'll put in our requests and go from there. We do have another email here. I'll pass this one to Alan because it mentions NAND in it, and that frightens all the rest of us.
All right, email from Chris in Indiana. Not to take anything against the tragedies happening in Japan, but I read somewhere that 40% of the world's NAND flash memory is produced there. I'm sure you guys have not heard anything official, nor will you probably hear anything, but how will you expect the earthquake / tsunami / possible nuclear meltdown, oh my god, to affect the prices of SSDs? I know the prices won't go down, but do you expect them to go up? I actually have a little bit of an answer for that. Yes, prices of NAND have jumped a little bit. That's the bad news. The good news is it hasn't gone up by that much. To give you an example, street price of 120 gig SSD that I sort of picked at random here, recently jumped from 200 to 215. So you're looking at, 7% jump? So that's not horrible, and I think that's around where it's expected to settle. Like, in other words, the price hike has already happened, and it probably won't be any worse.
Gotcha.
And it would hopefully get better, once these plants can get back operational.
Huh. All right.
The because like Samsung, I think they do some NAND, don't they, Alan?
Oh yes.
Yeah, they have plants in Texas, Korea, and China, and none of those areas were affected by the tsunami, and they're still a major producer of these chips. And then we've got Intel, who's got the the big conglomerate with Micron in Utah, and that certainly wasn't affected by it. And it may have been affected by the polygamous show that Bill got killed in this past week, but probably not tremendously.
It's the platter-based stuff that's going to get hit. According to DigiTimes, Seagate and Western Digital, their hard drives are platter-based storage, all essentially sitting in vulnerable parts of Japan. So that is actually one of the few places that we've seen is going to say, that has already said, you know, we are having major supply problems. I mean, there's some IC companies as well as a lot of car manufacturers that are going to be hit by the fact you can't really bring raw materials in there anymore. You don't have many runways for airplanes. You essentially don't have docks. But for the vast majority of it, they're not located in Japan. You know, there is going to be some impact, but it's not worth panicking over.
Good. No need to stock up on SSDs. That's good information. All right, that's all the emails we got. We got some more of those. If you have questions, please send them in. podcast@pcper.com, 1-888-38-PCPER. Let's get into our hardware software picks of the week. My first pick was going to be this HTC Thunderbolt on Verizon that uses the 4G LTE network. But because I know how excited everybody is on this particular show about telephones, I won't get too far into it other than, you know, download speeds 4G of about 11 megs. That's okay in my book. Battery life apparently not that great. The other thing I'll ask here is my software pick is chat room vote here. Is Crysis 2 really that bad? We've read some interesting
scathing
perspectives.
Scathing.
On it, scathing. Yes. That basically accuse it of Crytek of selling out to the consoles and this kind of stuff, that it looks like crap, all that kind of stuff. And what's interesting is, I mean, it's not as super stressful on your system. I still think it looks good. Like, we played the game here for, I don't know, maybe about 15 or 20 minutes or something like that today. I think it looks good. Is it pushing your system as much? Is it maybe as forward-looking as Crysis was at the time? Absolutely not. Gameplay, look, it's a first-person shooter. But, you know, when Medal of Honor came out, I don't remember anybody jumping on the bandwagon, destroying it on the PC like that, and it was less stressful on a PC than Crysis 2 is by far.
What was that game again?
Medal of Honor.
Oh, I think
it was Black Ops. Blops.
No, that's Call of Duty Black Ops. Medal of Honor was like the new one, like the reset of Medal of Honor. And Call of Duty Black Ops wasn't anything real strong, wasn't that, you know, hard on the PC either. You know, I still think it looks good. We're going to use it as a test, I'm sure, to some degree or another. I just want to know.
You want to test DirectX 11 cards?
Yeah, but you don't have to use DirectX 11 to test DirectX 11 cards. And in fact, the majority of games that are out today aren't DirectX 11 enabled games. I haven't heard. Have we seen a final verdict on when DirectX 11 is coming? That it's not there today.
Best case, it's not there. Best case scenario is it will come out as a patch, which means you're looking at situations you've seen in other places where it doesn't take advantage of tessellation or anything. It just runs more efficiently.
Okay. Yeah. Which would make it even less stressful on your computer. Anyway, it doesn't look like a lot of people in the chat room have actually played it yet. Some people are saying, Lil Hamlet saying, didn't even consider buying it. Somebody says it's terrible. Maybe, like I said, I'm not even really like defending it. I'm more defending its ability to exist and to attempt to defend itself, I guess. So I'm not saying it's a pick to go buy it right away. But give it a shot, let some things settle in, and see where it goes out from there. Next on our list is Jeremy, who could harp on Crysis 2, but...
Kind of already did, and I linked to Kyle at Hard OCP, who pretty much summed it up much better than I could right now.
he talks about genitals of both sides when comparing it to this particular title.
Something tells me he enjoyed posting that far more than he enjoyed playing the game.
Yeah, yeah.
But what's actually got me worried is you'll all remember not more than a month ago, we had a nice little worm that came out which targeted Siemens WinCC SCDACs or SCADAs or supervisory control and data acquisition things, which are the software that controls actual physical industrial components in, you know, semi-important things like nuclear plants and gas refineries. And, you know, it used a little vulnerability with autoplay mixed with a control panel icon, which you plug a USB drive in and boom, you're infected. If you plug that into a system that's running this particular SCADA program, it's now going to start overclocking the actual physical rotating pieces and burn them out. Well, we just had something come out called Agora SCADA Plus, which you can buy from a certain Russian website, which has 22 different modules which will exploit these SCADA controls for every single major company on the planet. Siemens, Iconix, Datatec, Control Microsystems, all the guys who are running the really old plants. So right. You got 34 vulnerabilities for 22. 11 of them are zero-day vulnerabilities. They're already friggin' out there in the wild. And so a really good guy, apparently, called Luigi Arumana, or Ariema, you know, good luck on the pronunciation with that, just released proof of concept for 34 vulnerabilities to the good guys, more or less. He's put these out as a paper saying, this is what I've found. Most of them, it's just code execution, so you're not actually going to be physically hacking things, you know, like the dream of loading a virus onto someone's PC and causing their PSU to explode. Most of them aren't quite that way. The others grab sensitive data, so it's like, hey, I wonder how I run a nuclear plant. I wonder if I could download all the control schematics for them. Not so much the blueprints, but what the software is actually doing. And there's one that is actually a physical hack. You apply this virus to one of these control systems in a nuclear power plant or gas refinery or any major industrial complex that's been around for 30 years plus, and you will be physically destroying equipment.
Huh.
Hey, you know, like ubiquitous technology, but, you know, there's a lot of people that really have to catch up on, hey, just about anything can be hacked.
Sure.
You're scary.
I'll drink to that.
Yeah.
Josh, what do you got?
Me? You know, I just picked up a game last week, Sins of a Solar Empire. It's been out for a while. They've released two expansions to it, and you can get it for like $39 for all three. So I started that out. I really enjoyed it. It's not a bad thing. You can do, the direct download from Stardock, I believe it is. The only downside is you have to use their Steam-like client to be able to do it, and it's a little annoying, but it's not too bad as compared to other things it could be. So for $39, it's many, many, many hours of enjoyment, good-looking graphics, multiplayer, single-player, you name it. It's not too shabby. Sins.
Ooh.
Anything with Sins, it's got to be good.
Now, Alan, you're calling this your pick, Drobo OMG?
Something like that. So there's a model coming out from Drobo that's the B1200i. It's like a business class version of this thing. So they've in the past, they've made like the 8-bay Drobo Pro that, you know, you put 8 drives in it, and they make like a rack mount kit that you can buy for it that extends the sides out a little bit so it can fit in a rack, standard rack, and it's like a 3U height thing in there. And so that's kind of all good and well, but there's an awful lot of like empty space on either side there that's sort of wasteful. And so there's a business model that's coming out that's a 12 bay that just takes the entire, it's like basically just 12 drives all in a row, and it's a Drobo, and it has a triple gigabit Ethernet, and it acts like a SAN.
With it's only 3 gigabit Ethernet? Come on.
No, there's actually a fourth one for management off to the side, but you know, for data moving, there's only 3. Only. Yeah. So the thing.
How much is it going to cost us?
I don't even know yet. It's not even out for like another month. But
$100 billion.
Wait, there's a buy now, but no, price unavailable. Nope, sorry, can't tell you. It's going to be expensive, but I like it.
Awesome. All right, that's it. We're going to wrap up the show. Those are our hardware software picks of the week. If you want to share this podcast with others, pcper.com/podcast. Follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/PCPer, or even if you're so interested, twitter.com/RyanShrout. What do we got? We have a Facebook page, I think, as well, facebook.com/PCPer. You can follow Alan Malventano on Facebook. Just add him. He loves friends. Look at him.
Look at him. He just loves friends.
He just loves friends.
Oh,
great. Here they come. I'm going to get like 3 friends. Friend requests now. Thanks a bunch.
Look for the Alan Malventano that lives in Seattle. That's the key, though, because he tries to hide his location and all that kind of stuff.
Seattle? Okay.
Yeah, exactly. That's it. We're going to wrap up the show. Thank you, everybody, for watching. Thanks, everybody, watching live. If you want to watch us live, you can make yourself do that, I guess, if you want. We record it, Wednesdays, 10 p.m. Eastern Time, 7 p.m. Pacific, live.twit.tv, or most of the time, if you go to pcper.com, we have a news post up there as well. Or you follow me on Twitter, I post before we go live on that as well. So I'm Ryan Shrout.
Jeremy Hellstrom. Josh Walrath, not Jeremy Hellstrom.
And Al Malventano, not Jeremy Hellstrom.
I'm not muted anymore. We'll edit out that big pause and post, I'm sure. Thanks, everybody, for watching.
It was my best performance forever.
See you next week.
Good night.